My friends and I saw what had to have been the Dog Man. We want to see this thing again. Go away, kid. Are these stories real? Please, you tell us. What I mean is, did any of the following actually happen as described in these scary stories? The black-eyed kid in my bedroom closet. Dear Scary Stories NYC, I think human beings are some sort of electrical conductors. I believe that when our vibrations hit certain levels, we actually ourselves become energy vortexes capable of opening doorways and allowing things from other realities to get into our world. In other words, I think we ourselves can become haunted. I don't base this theory on mere conjecture, though. This theory was entirely inspired by an experience I had when there was a black-eyed kid in my bedroom closet. I've lived alone for almost a year now since my wife left me. The guy she left me for is far richer than myself, so I don't have to pay alimony, and I got to keep the house. I also got to keep the horrible, emasculating feeling that the woman you loved and swore to devote your life to was only ever after money. She just used me as a stepping stone to get out of poverty and to meet someone truly rich. I haven't dated since then. At first because I was still recovering emotionally from being dumped suddenly, and since that because of the stupid unending quarantine. I don't really have any desire to date while wearing a surgical mask. It's like something out of Kafka. So there I was, sleeping alone in my giant bed, and I heard a scratching and a high-pitched giggling from the closet in my room. This caused me to sit straight up, as I have no children, and that sounded like a child was in my closet. I keep an old school flashlight in one of the drawers next to my bed because my ex-wife used to think we had mice in our bedroom. I never saw them myself, but she said she could hear them scratching and skittering in the dark. So I got out what I call my mouse flashlight and I shone it around near the closet. Was it mice making that noise? But then I heard the scratching sound again, and when I shone the light on the closet door, I could see it moving, slightly. This was the most terrifying moment in my life. I had to do something about this. I was going to have to get out of bed and address this situation. I couldn't leave a child locked in my bedroom closet. How had it gotten there? I got out of bed, and on shaky legs, I walked over to the door, and I whispered, "Are you trapped in there?" I heard the giggling again, which sent chills up and down my spine. That just was not an appropriate reaction to my question. I pulled on the doorknob, but sure enough, the door was actually locked, and it was locked from my side. In other words, whoever was in there could not have locked themselves in. I had to have locked the door, which I didn't remember doing. I turned the old key in the old lock, heard it open, and heard more childish laughter. At this point, I stopped and pinched myself, hoping that would wake me up. I kind of wanted this to be a dream, and I wanted this dream to be over. When I was still standing there listening to giggling, I took a deep breath, braced myself, and pulled the closet door open quickly, shining the flashlight into the darkness and finding a boy, aged maybe 14, older looking than what he had sounded like while giggling. He was blonde, with messy hair, and when he looked up at me, all the light of that flashlight still did not put any color in his eyes. I gasped in horror as I realized this kid had entirely black eyes, no whites at all. My shock caused him to grin, and he either had fanged teeth or very jagged and broken ones, but I only saw them for a split second as the grinning kid pushed between my legs and exited the room so fast, you would have thought it was a scene from The Matrix or something. He ran into the hallway outside my bedroom, and I could hear him running downstairs at an incredibly fast pace. Like, imagine the speed a rat or a mouse could go. But imagine the sound a 14-year-old boy would make going that quickly. It was a really horrible sound. It was nauseating to consider. I never heard the black-eyed boy leave my house. I don't know for a fact that he isn't still here. I think he left, though. I'm not too concerned about that. One of the only friends I still have told me that my house is haunted, so I should sell it and move. I agree with him that I should sell the house, and I am going to contact real estate people this week and start that ball rolling. Too many bad memories here. Too much of my ex-wife still here. But I don't think the house is what's haunted. I think I am. I think that wherever I move, I'm going to continue to have bad experiences like this. If it's not a black-eyed kid in my closet, it'll be ghosts, or UFOs, or Bigfoot, or Dogman. I am a haunted man, and I will continue to be until I have a happier life to live. I need more sunshine. I need more laughter. I need camaraderie and friends again. Eventually, I will get these healthy things back in my life. Then, I won't be such a tuning fork for misery. Then, I won't vibrate at such a negative vibration that I open doors for monsters to enter our world. Once my life is healthy and normal again, I won't have to worry any more about running into the black-eyed kid in my bedroom closet. Today's executive producer is Catherine Heroy. Catherine Heroy brings us lots of joy. She's the coolest one that's ever been. Last name Heroy, first Catherine. If you would like to help us with the increasingly difficult prospect of trying to stay on the air, you can like, subscribe, or better yet, join our channel memberships by clicking the join link below this video. That grants you access to our weekly secret uncensored episodes far too wild to run on this channel. And now, for something completely Dogman. Dogman is better than Netflix. As we settle into week 97 of our two-week quarantine here in America, many of us have turned our thoughts to what has changed. Hollywood and sports have become nostalgia topics, with very few interested any longer in watching the modern output of either. Other than The Boys, I haven't watched a TV series since Ash vs. the Evil Dead got canceled. For the most part, when my friends and I have our water cooler discussions about TV shows, it's now shows from our past that we've been rewatching, or old shows and movies that we never heard of before and are discovering for the first time. It's the same with music and comic books and the rest of the culture. Many of the best comics ever made are all available for free online, legally. Of course, most of them were drawn before we were born. You can read them online or download them, as the vast majority of comic books ever made are now in the public domain. Honestly, when my friends and I look at new programming lately, it's stuff created by individuals on YouTube, BitChute, Minds.com, and places like that. I even get my news from citizen journalists. I don't trust news from a source that spent $1 million on the set they shoot on. For some of my friends, this change was gradual and has been going on for the past few years. But for me, it only began when the quarantine and the needless destruction started. My mind got changed fast when I saw the plot of the movie Joker play out in real time before my eyes. I wondered why it seemed that Hollywood knew this was going to happen at least a year or two ago. I felt like I was smelling the same rat my friends had been telling me they were smelling. And so I turned off Hollywood's TV, and I turned off Hollywood's sports and their culture, and I joined my friends a little late to the party. "What does this have to do with Dogman?" I hear you ask, at least the more impatient and cranky of you. I will get to the Dogman in the very next sentence. My friends and I saw what had to have been the Dogman when we planned on being inside watching an old movie. After that, everything else in our lives has sort of subsided in either direction because we want to see this thing again. Let me give you the details. I don't want to say exactly where we are centered, but it is to the east of where this story took place. We're supposed to meet at my place for a double or triple feature, pizza, maybe some gaming. At the last second, one of our group, who we can call Felix Unger, was told by his wife that he had to vacate what was now her home. Actually, it was her family's home that they had used as a summer place, and it was out in the country, sort of near Addison, Pennsylvania. So, Felix Unger had us all driving out to his ex-wife's family's summer home to get his stuff from her before she set it on fire in the backyard. When we got there, it turned out it was all garbage he should have thanked her to trash for him. Old broken computers, a broken ColecoVision set. ColecoVision! Imagine that. Clothes with moth holes in them. My car and trunk were filled up with garbage as Felix and his ex-wife shouted at each other. It was a fun afternoon that stretched on past sunset. Once we got going back east, though, there was an instant sense of relief among us since the worst of the day was now over. Even Felix perked up a bit, and we declared that the rest of the day was going to be all fun. We weren't more than 5 or 7 minutes into our long journey back to the city when we had the Dogman encounter that completely changed all of our lives. It was on National Parkway, and we were passing this sort of barn-looking building along the side of the road. My buddy, who I won't name, started screaming, "Don't hit the furry! Don't hit the furry!" I almost looked back at my friend because I didn't understand the joke he was making, but then I saw what he meant, and I saw that he wasn't joking around. There was a guy in a head-to-toe fur costume that had a dog head on top, and he was running out onto the road from behind that little barn-like building, heading straight in front of where I was driving. At least, that's what my first impression was, that it was a furry. I swerved to my right to avoid hitting the idiot and screeched to a stop. The furry kept running toward us, so I opened the door and I took a step out to give him a piece of my mind. I guess I felt brave with my buddies backing me up, but also, I didn't think a furry would be all that tough. The thing is, when I stepped out of that car, the thing I saw running toward me didn't look like a furry. I felt like I stood there for a really long time, trying to understand what I was looking at. It didn't make sense to me. I couldn't see how it could be a costume. The middle part of the body was too thin to fit a human inside. The legs were not shaped in a way that human legs could contort themselves. I remember feeling so confused and admitting that I couldn't figure out how that could be a costume. It looked like a real dog-headed man running toward me. It even had drool flying out of its mouth on either side as it ran bipedally. When my eyes met his, and I saw the rage in them, I understood that it didn't matter what this creature was, so much as it mattered that it meant to do me and my buddies harm. I pulled myself back into the car, realizing that my friends had been screaming at me to get back in for some time before I did so. Once my door was shut and locked, they screamed at me to drive. It seemed like a good idea, but my reactions were slowed by how stunned I was in the moment. Before I could turn the key to restart the engine, the dog-headed whatever it was slammed sideways into my front end, then climbed onto the hood of my car, baring its teeth at us and making me wonder how strong my windshield actually was. Now, you would think that five grown men together would feel brave enough to deal with an animal attack. After all, there was only one animal, and five of us. You would be wrong to think that, though. My friends scream when they see a mouse or a water bug. Just imagine their reaction to what had to have been a dog man on the hood of my car. They were in utter panic. In my stunned state, looking around at my friends flipping out and screaming like little kids, I felt like the world was in slow motion. Have you ever had one of those experiences? You sort of move into shock and then move right past it. The dog man, the humans, all of them caught up in some kind of play being performed for my benefit. What was my part in the play? It suddenly seemed as clear as my windshield what to do. I started the car, and I drove it backward, sharply and quickly, and the animal fell off the hood. I kicked the car into gear and floored it, heading straight toward the dog man. In that slowed down state, I felt I could see every single detail that there was to see. I felt like Ted Williams seeing by the spin of the threading on the baseball exactly how it would curve and where it would move. I knew which way that dogman was going to go, and I headed directly there. Would it challenge me? I was betting that it wouldn't. But as we drove toward the monster and my friends screamed all around me, I calculated our chances in my head. That beast was tall, and it looked stronger than an ape. But it stood on those long, thin, bony legs, and that was what I was driving directly toward. And as we were about to meet in space and time, I witnessed the immense beast gracefully leap into the air and fly up out of my line of vision. I heard it slam hard on our roof with no grace at all, and I witnessed it somersaulting off the car to run away on all fours behind some buildings behind us. My friends were in a bad state, and it smelled terribly inside that car. As scared as I still was of that dog man, I rolled down my window to get some fresh air anyway. Those boys had been scared to within an inch of their lives. Now, we were all fairly traumatized by this unexpected event. It really came out of nowhere, and to say that we were surprised doesn't even explain a fraction of it. However, already, by the next day, the event had become something more like a thrill ride we had survived, like a Halloween haunted house that you were brave enough to get through. I was the only one who had looked at the dogman in the eye, so my friends wanted me to describe all the details for them. What I told them was that I saw a gray animal, mostly solid gray, and it was most definitely a male. The legs were like dog's legs, but thicker and stronger, as they were built to carry the entire creature upon them when it walked bipedally. The front legs of the creature were much like arms, at least the way it held them out in front like that. The ears and the face were quite wolf-like, but the eyes were crazy-looking. I don't know that the creature wasn't diseased or insane the way it attacked us. Were we really the easiest prey it had chanced upon that night? Why attack a car? Weren't there any squirrels or rabbits to have for dinner? Another observation I should note is that when it ran away in the end of our encounter, it did so on all fours. It looked perfectly natural doing so, just as it had looked natural running bipedally. I did not witness any sort of transformation. It just fell forward onto its hands and ran away in a canine fashion. So, now since that night, we've been going out twice or three times a week and driving around that part of Pennsylvania. Well, four out of five of us go out. Felix Unger stays home. He's afraid his ex-wife will see him out there in her neighborhood and think he's stalking her. I don't blame him because she probably would think that. But each time we drive out there, we get another idea about what we should do next time. Like, we have an infrared camera now, and we were thinking about buying a 360-degree light and mounting it on top of my car. We would shoot out of the windows in the infrared until we saw something. Then, we'd turn on the overhead lights and take all the brightly lit monster photos we would want to take. We haven't actually done that yet, it's just an idea at this stage. We never want to camp out in that area or look for the dogman outside of the safety of our car. I never want to see another dogman unless there's steel and glass between us. But I do want to see one again. I want proof of what is out there, and I want that proof to belong to me and my buddies. They were talking about having a GoFundMe to raise money for equipment, but I just want us to do this by ourselves, so that when we finally have our proof, we can take all the credit and all the glory. Since that night when I saw that crazy dogman running straight at me, I've been feeling sort of weirdly chosen. I kind of feel like it's my destiny to finally put out some proof that this creature is actually a real thing. And so that's why my buddies and I think Dogman is better than Netflix.
Thanks for watching till the end. If you liked what you saw, please consider clicking like on the video or sharing it. You can become a channel member by clicking the join link below. Then you can check our community page to find the links to 10 hours or more of secret, uncensored Dogman stories too wild to be told on this channel. Your other option is to join our paid subscribers club at peterbernard.com. That's Peter's homemade club, where he will personally email you the links as well as occasional secret club messages. You may also be included as an executive producer in a future episode. You have a scary experience you want to tell us about? You can email us at scarystoriesnyc@gmail.com or else call our Scary Stories voicemail hotline at 804-LESS-SCARY. The machine cuts off every few minutes, so if you have a long story, please keep calling back and we'll piece it together later on. Good night and have a scary tomorrow.
Scary story.